So to kick us off, we actually have our friend Amber Jackson of the Black Leaf Tea and Culture Shop doing a short flash talk to talk about her startup story, how she's evolved and how she's growing and where she's headed next. So with that, Amber, I saw you on.
I'm right here.
Awesome. Well, I'm just going to pass it over to you. Great to have you here.
Great. Thank you, Avi. Thank you so much for having me here. As he said, my name's Amber Jackson. I'm the owner of the Black Leaf Tea and Culture Shop. So it is a loose leaf tea company. I design and formulate all my tea blends myself. I also have certain community aspects, community and social aspects as well, such as Rona, I hosted a monthly Young Black Professionals Mixer, as well as these conversation series called Tea Talks. And so these are, this is a platform that I created where we discuss anything from current events, Black culture, dating, sex, relationships, anything that affects us as Young Black millennials on a day-to-day basis. Just a quick backstory, I'm from Chicago. I moved to Providence November 2017, so it was almost 3 years. I work full-time at Brown, which is why I moved here. And when I came here, I quickly noticed the severe lack of diversity. I had an idea of how white it was going to be, and then I moved here. I realized I'm nowhere close is what I thought it was going to be. It was like I was one of very, very few. So when I first moved here, my coworkers would take me out places trying to be really nice. And every time, I was always either the only Black person in the room or the only Black female in the room. And it's an incredibly uncomfortable feeling. It's very isolating kind of feeling. And speaking to some of my other friends that work at Brown or transplants like myself, same story. They just did not feel like we had a home here. Not that people weren't welcoming. It's just that it did not feel welcoming just because we did not see ourselves here. And so I wanted to create a business to not only establish some financial independence for myself, but also to be able to share my love for tea and my creativity. So for me, my creative avenue is food, tea, and beverages. And not only as a creative in the food and beverage aspect, but also creating a space. My Young Black Professionals mixers I have were because the Urban League is not active here. I'm from Chicago. I went to undergrad and grad school in the South. It is incredibly active. And to not have it here, when I spoke to some of my other colleagues that are also Black transplants, same thing. We looked for the Urban League. First thing we did, where's the Urban League? There isn't one here. There's one in Boston, but I am not driving an hour to be around people that look like me. I'm not doing it. So for me, it was really I got to create a space and curate conversations for people that look like me that did not have that space. So it wasn't only just being able to create a product, but actually filling a void in the city. So initially the idea was not loose leaf tea. It was initially going to be sweet tea and cheesecakes. I quickly learned that is incredibly expensive, especially when you're starting a business out of your own pocket. So the cheesecakes and sweet tea did not happen. Sweet teas will be coming soon, just not now, just because that takes a whole other level of capital and time that I don't have. So at that time, it was maybe October of 2018. I'm thinking like, okay, well, if I drink tea every day, if I learn how to formulate this on my own, put in a bag, I can sell online wherever all year round. I don't need a physical space. It makes sense. And so I ordered some ingredients in my mind made sense to create just a couple staple blends. And I quickly learned that I'm really good at this. So academically, my background is in food science, concentrating in product development. So I've always loved playing with food. And so for me, beyond anything else, I know flavor. Even at like Thanksgiving dinner, my family calls me slow and steady because I will sit there for an hour with one single plate because I like to taste everything. I cannot eat fast. It does not work for me. I like to, because for me, food and beverage is an experience. It should be. You're creating an experience with texture and flavor. And that's what I really want to create with my tea blends as well. So with that, outside of a physical, just the business itself, I knew that this is something that I wanted to potentially go full-time with. And so the name of the game for me was longevity. So from October 2018, I was searching around for a shared kitchen space because I know that legally I cannot do this out of my own home, even though all I need is a bowl. And that's it. So it's a little annoying in that aspect. But initially, I was going to be at a food kitchen in Providence, but literally 1 week after visiting, they closed. And so I'm like, oh my God, where do I go? And someone told me about Hope in Maine. And so I did their food cohort in October of 2018. Luca was on here, so I met Luca as well. Hi, Luca. And so it was great to have that one space that everything was serviced to me as a new food business. So the food business cohort, being able to do the safe serve course there as well. So it made it a much simpler transition for me when it came to figuring out how do I do this, because my background is not in business, it's in science. I have no idea what in the hell I am doing. I don't know legal forms. I don't know where to find these things. Someone's like, oh, you need an EIN number. I'm like, where? Explain. It's not as simple as saying, go do this, go do this. As I think people have to understand, as new food businesses, a lot of us, we simply do not know. So simply saying, yeah, you just need this, this, and this. I don't know what this means. And so Hope in Maine really broke those things down to me to make that transition much easier. And from there, they also linked me with a lawyer because, like I said, for me, it was about longevity. And so I think, I know a lot of food businesses, they kind of work at home for a while and just test things out. And then they file for their LLC. I started my LLC first and got everything situated legally before I did anything else. So I did a package deal with Barton Gilman, which works with Hope in Maine. I think Luke linked me with them, actually. And so they filed my LLC and my trademark together. I was a little nervous at first. I'm like, I might want to change my name later because it's so long. I don't mind it now. So I just kept the name. So I trademarked the name. So legally, it took about a year, just the whole legal process. I believe it's 3 or 4 months that has to go along with no one contesting that name use. So as of December of 2019, the name, the Black Leaf Tea and Culture Shop, federally belongs to me. So for me, it's about ownership and legality. And that, for me, in my mind, all goes towards longevity, because a lot of times people don't think about those small things. It seems small, being like, you know, filing your taxes is oftentimes an afterthought because you have so much going on with the day to day, you kind of forget sometimes. Registering your business is incredibly important, understanding that a lot of, you know, grants, loans, you're not able to apply for because you're not legally a business. So those things were very, very important to me before I started my business. So once I had that situated, and also because I work full-time managing 38 teams, after work, I am dead to this world. I do not trust myself to handle legal documents at all. So using them was incredibly helpful, and just making sure that my business, from the foundation of my business, was stable. That was the most important thing for me. Beyond the product itself, making sure the foundation of my business was stable was my number one priority. Once I had this situated, I was still, you know, trying to, you know, playing around with herbs and blends to see what worked. And it was just a lot of trial and error. It wasn't just like, okay, I'm gonna just get this and this and measurement. It was a lot of trial and error. A lot of calling my friends over saying, hey, I need you to taste this. And just do it kind of like some at home tea tastings. I would just be in the kitchen. I would make dinner. It's like, look, I can't pay you, but I cooked. Come taste this. And we just have like a little like tea party at home. And from there, I started my business with 4 tea blends. I blended and packaged at Hope in Maine. It took some time, even finding, I think for me, it was like, okay, finding herbs is easy. However, I don't have the time nor finances to fly to China and Taiwan and Japan to actually get tea leaves. How do I do this? And I was talking once again to Luca, and I was like, I need help. He's like, oh, we have an in-person, in-house person. I'm like, oh. And a lot of times I've learned as well, it just takes you opening your mouth and just asking things, because if you don't know something, someone else surely does. And he linked me with Michelle Chang, who owns Leafy Green Tea and also Ceremony, which is on Thayer Street. She mentors me still to this day. about a lot of things. So she buys her teas directly. So she, even last summer, she was in Japan for 2 weeks. She lived with the farmers and things like that. She took videos. She let me see the process of making matcha tea, which is incredibly tedious, which is why I know what that green sludge you get from Dunkin' Donuts is not matcha. I learned a lot from her when it comes to the actual learning about the end of actual tea leaves itself. And so she's, like me, incredibly picky. And so I trust her when it comes to buying my tea leaves wholesale from her. And so from there, I started my business. Well, I released the website April 11th of 2019. And from there, it was doing small pop-ups. My very first one was in Pawtucket, and I was ecstatic because I made $500 in like the first hour. I'm like, oh my God, I made so much money. Got home, I was like, oh, I need more ingredients. I need more packaging. I need to buy more labels. And so that's one thing when it comes to running your business out of your own pocket without outside funding. It's just a recycling of funds. I had to learn that, okay, in order for me to actually make money, I'm going to really need to bulk up my inventory. That's the only way. And so there were many, many sleepless nights just because I was just like, okay, I need to get these things done because the demand is there. But if the demand is there and I don't have the supply, I'm going to lose business. And so I had to learn quickly to just get things done and pack. I hope in May, I would go at like late at night because I know no one else will be there. And I can just stay there and pack without any distractions. Over the summer, I started doing the farmers markets at the schoolyard market at Hope in Maine. And I learned quickly as well, the people that I thought were going to be my audience were not. So I thought because I'm kind of branded my business around Black culture and being in like millennial kind of base and being with actual people buying my product, I learned, oh no, most of my buyers are older white women. Did not think that, but cool. But even things like that is so important to get your brand and your product out there because that's a great way to really identify who is your market. And from there, so I kind of had to tweak my branding just a little bit or who I gauge my branding towards based off of that because these are the people that are buying my brand. So buying my product. So no matter what I want it to be, this is who's buying it. And I think a lot of times, a lot of people, their businesses, I hate to say they fail, is because they're not willing to adjust when they need to. When everything is telling you, you need to go down road A, but in your mind, you plan for road B. So you're sticking to road B because you plan road B. A lot of people kind of fail in that way because they're not willing to adjust when they need to, when and where they need to. And so for me, it was just really listening to my audience, paying attention to who that is, that really pushed things forward. They came to October of 2019. I got my first wholesale deal with Stop Culinary Goods on Hope Street in Providence, Rhode Island, which was very ironic to me because I was actually about to dissolve my business because even though it was going incredibly well, it was so much time and so much money and so many tears. My therapist, I'm sure she was tired of me at that point as well. I was exhausted because I own and operate alone. So everything, every tea blend, every package, every label, every shipment, that is solely me. And it was a lot to try to figure everything out as a business while running a business, while having a full-time job. It was a lot. And so I was crying to my friend on Mondays, like, I can't keep doing this. This is too much. And then on Wednesday, I got an email from Jan and she just said, she followed my Instagram page. And so I followed you since you started your business. I love seeing your successes. Do you wholesale and would you like to start here? And I just cried. I'm like, yeah, sure. And that's how I got started with my wholesaling. And because a lot of people, they know Stock Culinary Goods, they know Jan. And then for me, it just makes sense because a lot of times people bring me offers for certain things. And even I was doing summer markets at Hope in Maine, I had about two people and they wanted a 50% profit margin. And I had to tell them no, because even though I wanted to be in people's stores, it didn't align. I'm just starting out. I designed this myself. Everything is by hand myself. And you want 50% of my work? Absolutely not. And so for me, it was about everything I do is about alignment. Every good idea, every offer is not a good idea if it simply does not align. And it's okay to say no, because ultimately for me, that's worked in my favor. Every offer does not, it doesn't get a yes from me, because many of them is an absolute no, just because it solely does not align with my work, my effort, my branding, my product. It just does not align. And that's incredibly important. And so from there, it's riding the wave. You have a lot of ups and downs, where people come in, it's little slow periods. And then coronavirus hit and I was a little nervous, but actually my business started booming through a pandemic. It's a health and wellness process, a tea product. I don't promote outwardly health conditions and how it can help you, just because legalities, I'm not about to be sued for somebody saying, I took this to cure my cancer and it didn't work. I do not brand for health purposes. It's just like, this tastes good, this goes good with this, you should try it. It works for me. And that's the thing too. If you want to go about things because that's the way you want them to be, sure, just go about the actual legal routes of doing it. I don't have the funds nor time, nor do I care to do so. So I'm not doing it. And then from there in June, with a lot of the social and racial tensions in this country, there's a big push to promote Black-owned businesses. And before then, I was maybe getting 1-2 sales every other week or so. It feels pretty slow. But one thing is, just a way I might get a week of great sales, a week of no sales at all. And then that, I think it was around Juneteenth, they really pushed to promote Black-owned businesses. And I sold out and I had to figure out how I need to fulfill 61 orders at one time. I've never had 61 orders to fulfill at one time. So I had to put a note on my website. Orders would be fulfilled in 7 to 10 business days. Did I need that amount of time? No, but for my peace of mind, 7 to 10 business days. And it's just really, it's a courtesy to your customers, just saying but before I could just pump out, go to the post office that day, the day after, because I only had one sale, I need more time. And it's okay to tell your customers hey, I need a little more time. And having that transparency and good communication with your customers is also incredibly important. You can just say, my customers know it's just me. I don't have a team, but they appreciate that kind of authenticity and just respect as a consumer, because I, as a consumer, also want the same. If you need more time, just say you need more time. And that worked for me. From there, I've had consistent sales where I make at least 2-3 sales every single day. Because every month I'm bringing in at least $2,000 every month now. And so when that hit, it's like I had to quickly change to where I have to figure out how do I keep this going while also in a pandemic. And the issue was not sales, it was actually retaining inventory, because shipping takes so long. So that first month that it hit, it took a little over a month to get one shipment of ingredients. So I was just sitting for a month waiting on ingredients. So you have to really just adjust. And once that hit, kind of I have the money for it now, give me everything you got. And I just bulked up my ingredient stock. And from there I was able to just, really, cause I'm working from home now, I have the time to, to focus on my virtual tea talks now. So people actually have been following my page now because of those things. So it's really just learning how to capitalize when those things do come and preparing for the best, for where you want your business to be and not where you are.
This is such a great story. Also, in many ways, covering a lot of the things that we're planning on talking, unpacking in the next, specifically next half an hour, 40 minutes, specifically in this early stage. A couple of questions before we move on, because we are running a little behind, but I feel like I'd be remiss if we didn't dive a little deeper. I think one thing that's really awesome about your business, and you're considering so many different things, but it's great. You have a shelf-stable product. You have something that's relatively easy to manufacture or package. Were these conscious decisions when you, or were you just like, oh, only after the fact, you're like, oh, this is way easier than doing a bottled tea?
I think for me, I'm very, very calculated. So it just made sense. Fiscally, it made sense where I just like I said, with cheesecakes and iced and sweet tea, they need to be refrigerated constantly. So even just that alone, it will cost me. And so having something that's shelf stable, that if the package is closed, it can last a long time. And beyond that, I can have an e-commerce business. I have no limits to where I can ship to, who can actually get my product. Especially nowadays with, it worked in my favor, especially with the coronavirus. You had a lot of people scrambling to create websites and get in touch with, you know, DoorDash and Uber Eats. I don't do that kind of shipping, but I ship any and everywhere in the US. I've had sales to Hawaii, Alaska, everywhere in the US. I haven't started international shipping yet just because that's a whole other logistics to figure out. But it, for me, it's just like, it made sense. Me being e-commerce business off the bat took any restraints off of who could possibly, who my brand and my product can actually reach.
And so I guess just to wrap up real quick, you mentioned possibly entering into the iced tea world or maybe having a retail space. What is next? What, despite COVID or in light of it, what do you see in the next year at least?
Well, if any of you, I know Lucas had it at the summer, at the schoolyard market last year. I did a iced tea called Peachy King, and it killed at the market. I think you guys had it too at the Adventure Cafe. So I was planning on bottling that. So I'm like, if I bottle this, I can put this in grocery stores, I can put it in restaurants, and I can also make it shelf stable where it doesn't have to be refrigerated. And that's a whole other set of revenue for me that will be great. And also, even if I just have sent someone else out to do samples at a grocery store, that won't take too much time. It doesn't cost me. I would like to, at some point, open a actual tea cafe. I don't think it'll be anytime soon just because I don't need to. That's a lot of money. That's rent. That's paying employees. That's paying more insurance that I already pay. It's just a lot of things right now. And actually was offered to me during quarantine, the actual space I actually wanted for my actual shop. But I'm like, no, that's a lot of money that I don't have to do right now, especially where my business is killing it online. Why just pay $45 a month for a commerce website? Why would I go from $45 to, however much for paying employees and rent and everything else? Like, it didn't make sense. So at some point, absolutely, yes. But the next year, I do want to convert over to, not convert, but add on bottled iced tea, but also my a subscription box. So for Black Friday, I'm releasing a holiday box set. And then from that, occasion boxes. And then I actually plan on going full-time with this next July. I'll be 30. So that'd be like my gift to myself. And I plan on, after that, I want to do like a monthly subscription box.
Fantastic. Oh my God, you're doing so much. It's so great to have met you a little over a year ago and see how things are evolving and see the success coming. So I have no doubt that you will meet all these goals.